Hello everybody and welcome to video number 22 of the online version of the Fusion Research Lecture. We are still in chapter 4 and in the last video we learned about banana orbits and banana particles. And in this video we will talk about another important result partly which comes from these banana particles. And this is the bootstrap current. So finally we talk about the bootstrap current. So the bootstrap current is based on the gradient drift, or the result of the gradient drift. And just as a reminder, this is V drift and then grad B. This is minus the perpendicular energy over the charge. The perpendicular gradient of the magnetic field times the magnetic field over the magnetic field to the power of 3. And now we are looking at the minus grad, let's use a different color for that. We're looking at the minus grad B times B theta, so times the Podol magnetic field direction component, let's say. And we will see that this results in a toroidal precession. Of the particles. So let's try to explain. Again, our typical coordinate system, x in this direction, the toroidal angle phi. This is the radial direction. We have the magnetic field pointing into the board. But it's maybe a bit hard to see. So we have the magnetic field pointing into the board, so to the phi direction. Then we have the gradient of the magnetic field pointing to the left. Now let's try to draw typical flux surface. It might look, for example, like this. And then we also have, here's our knot. We have the plasma current pointing into the board as well, like the magnetic field. This is the direction of the plasma current. Theta going into this direction, and what I have drawn here corresponds to illustrate a flux surface. And then we have a typical banana orbit, which can look, for example, like this. Right, so roughly like this. And then we have, and now I use blue for this, since we are looking at the result of the gradient drift, looking at the poloid magnetic field component. So the poloid magnetic field points in this direction downwards. So this is the poloid magnetic field, B theta. Points here into this direction, here into this direction, so it goes around into this direction, into this direction, here like this, like this, and finally here like this. Okay. Oh, I forgot to label this. There's a red line should correspond to a flux surface, sorry, to a banana orbit. Banana orbit. And now let's look at the grad B times the poloidal magnetic field component. If you now make the cross product, the grad B direction pointing to the left, as indicated by the arrow on the top, on the bottom left, then times the poloidal magnetic field component, we end up with the direction of this drift pointing here and into the board. Look at the minus sign in front of the drift. On the other side, it points out of the board, where the poloidal magnetic field pointing is pointing upwards. Since here it is still pointing upwards, but it is a bit weaker, pointing upwards. Here it is zero at the top and at the bottom. Here it's pointing into the board. Again, pointing into the board. Thus, the grad B times B theta drift changes sign towards the high field side direction. So this is important to realize. The grad B times B theta drift changes sign towards the high field side, changes sign at R zero. Yeah, so here at R zero, it changes sign. Now this has, of course, consequences. It means that if we look first at, let's look just at ions, so at positively charged particles, we will get a drift into the plus phi direction. This is a unit vector to phi direction. If we are at radial positions larger than the major radius of the plasma. So everything on this side here, for this we will get a positive, into positive phi direction a drift. We will get a drift in the other direction, so into negative phi direction for radial positions which are smaller than R0. And of course, well, not of course, but it's the opposite for electrons, as we have a charge dependence in the drift. Now if you look up here, you see there's a charge dependence. And this means that there is a, well, if you, well, not this, but if you look at the banana orbit in the poloidal projection, you see that there is a net drift into the plus phi direction, because the particles spend much more time on the on that part of the poloidal cross section. So there's a plus, a drift into the plus positive phi direction. This is the dominant part. And from this, a net current parallel to the plasma current can rise. And this is the bootstrap current. Okay. So the bootstrap current is a self-generated current, and I will explain this picture in a minute. The bootstrap current is a self-generated current which amplifies, amplifying the plasma current. So it flows in the same direction. And since it is self-generated by the plasma, this is called a bootstrap current. Bootstrap in that sense that that refers to somebody who pulls himself up by his own or her own bootstraps. And in the German, there's a German legend about not somebody who is using his own bootstraps, but somebody, and his name is Baron Münchhausen. So this refers to Münchhausen, who is able to drag himself out of the swamp. So this is a swamp where his horse is stuck in. So this is a swamp where his horse is stuck in. And then he just drags at his hair. He drags himself out of the swamp. So this is basically the same effect. Which is, of course, as you know, not possible, in contrast to the bootstrap current, which is a physical effect observed in plasma dynamics in the tokamak. So let's write down a quantitative estimation for the bootstrap current. So a quantitative estimation for the bootstrap current. This is J and then BS for bootstrap. Minus, then we have the square root of epsilon, the inverse aspect ratio, 1 over the poloidal magnetic field, B theta, and then the pressure gradient, the radial pressure gradient, dPdr. And what actually happens is the bootstrap current, that it's not the trapped particles alone which drive the current, but it's the trapped particles which transfer momentum via collisions, to passing particles. Which are then carrying the current, the toroidal net current. And since, as I said, what happens here is that the plasma creates its own poloidal magnetic field, confining itself, its own poloidal magnetic field. And this is why it's called a bootstrap current. Now, maximizing the bootstrap current, as you can easily imagine, maximize the bootstrap current in tokamaks allows for longer discharges and is therefore something which is of big importance. So maximize the bootstrap current in tokamaks allows for longer discharges, for longer discharge durations, let's say, for longer discharge durations. And for an economical device, for economic steady state operation, this is of vital importance. So this is of vital importance for an economic steady state operation. Steady state operation of a tokamak, as it reduces the need for an externally driven current. In stellarators, there is a counter contribution. There's a counter contribution from helically trapped particles, and we will discuss that in the next, or definitely in the next lectures and one of the next videos. There's a counter distribution from helically trapped particles, which goes in the opposite direction, and W7X, for example, is actually optimized for a minimum bootstrap current, such that these contributions cancel out, such that there's no additional bootstrap current which modifies the magnetic field further. Here you can see a time trace of an Astex upgrade discharge. So this is Astex upgrade. Astex upgrade from a series of experiments performed by Andreas Bock. And in different colors, you can see the different contributions to the overall plasma current. So in blue, we have ECCD, which is heating due to electron-cyclotron resonance heating. Then we have neutral beam injection in red. Then we have in gray the ohmic current. And then in yellow, the bootstrap current. And you can see that there's an area here, for example, where the majority of the plasma is not provided by ohmic heating, so not by an externally induced current, but actually by the sum of the bootstrap current and the neutral beam injection, and then partly of the microwave-driven current. So this is a very promising result, because this was an experiment at reactor-relevant conditions. Astex upgrade experiment at, let's say, reactor-relevant parameters or condition scenarios, I should say, at reactor-relevant scenarios. And this shows that we are ready to run these type of experiments in ITER with a clever setup where we do not can operate long discharges if we would only rely on the ohmic current. So we need additional currents in the bootstrap current, the combination of the bootstrap current, the neutral beam current, and in addition the ECCD, the microwave current, is the way to go here. So these were very promising experimental results from 2 years ago. Okay, there's another important and interesting effect. This is the so-called wear pinch. The wear pinch is a result of the fact that in a tokamak, the plasma current IP is driven by a toroidal electric field E5, which is of course due to the transformer effect, which is induced. Let's again try to explain that via a drawing. So this is X, this is the phi direction. Then we have here our typical tokamak coordinate system. This is R, oops, sorry. This is the R direction. This is the electric field direction, which drives the plasma current. So let's now draw the typical cross section. Looking, for example, like this. Plasma current pointing into this direction. So let's now again draw the unperturbed banana. Unperturbed banana orbit, for example, might look like this. So this would correspond to an unperturbed banana orbit. And now, if now the toroidal electric field results in an acceleration if the particle moves along the magnetic field, so parallel to B, the particle will be accelerated by that. And this means that the reflection of a trapped particle will happen at smaller radii, so deeper in the plasma. So let's try to illustrate that. If we start somewhere, maybe now here, for example, and the particle moves, and instead of being reflected here, it moves a bit further, like here. Then it moves upwards again against the magnetic field, and now it moves upwards against the magnetic field. And since it's decelerated moving against the magnetic field, since it moves against the electrical field, the the reflection happens at larger radii, then it moves down again, maybe something like this, up again, something like this, down again, and so on. So let's continue that. We said parallel to B, the particle is accelerated, the reflection happens deeper, where deeper here means at smaller radii. Whereas on the other hand side, if a particle moves anti-parallel to B, so against B, so against the electric field, it will be decelerated. There's a deceleration. That means that the reflection happens earlier. Reflection happens earlier, or to say the same thing is at larger radii. And the result is a tilt, as I have tried to indicate it here, of the banana orbits. A tilt of the banana orbits. And a net inward drift. A net inward drift. And this drift is called the Weir pinch, named after the physicist Weir, the Weir pinch. Now, let's try to estimate this with a few numbers here. So the change of the banana width between two reflections, this quantity can be estimated. So right now delta, because it changes, the banana width changes, this can be estimated by minus E phi over B theta times the transit time times square root of epsilon. So this corresponds to the displacement of particles per transit time. And from that, there's a negative sign, so these particles are displaced into values of smaller radii. An inward velocity results. An inward directed velocity results, v, where this can be approximated then by delta BA over the transit time, corresponding to minus E phi over B theta times the square root of epsilon. And note that this is the same for ions and electrons. So the Weir pinch is an inwards directed movement of electrons and ions as a result from the toroidal electric field which drives the plasma current induced by the transformer coils. Okay, so we introduced in this video the concept of the bootstrap current, which is a very important current in tokamaks, as this will be the current which drives most of the plasma current in large scale tokamak devices, together with the NBI, the neutral beam injection, and it allows to extend the operation of a discharge. And it is of vital importance for from an economical point of view, as this allows to make long discharges. Only this bootstrap current, which is self-generated by the plasma, this is why it's called bootstrap current, only this current allows to make the steady state operation which you need for a reactor. And then finally, we talked about the Weir pinch. And I've also shown you, by the way, experimental results indicating or illustrating that the bootstrap current is something which we can very well control already in a tokamak. I showed you in the last two slides, briefly introduced the Weir pinch, an inwards directed drift of electrons and ions in a tokamak as a result of the toroidal electric field, which is induced by ramping up or down a voltage in the primary circuit and the plasma being the secondary winding. Okay, that's it for video number 22. Hope to see you in the next video.